Hi, I'm Stefan, and I'm the organizer and host of the EMBO++, the next level conference for embedded software developers. The talk you're about to watch is about containers built for embedded software and servers. It was given by Robert Berger at the EMBO 2021. And thanks to Volkswagen Infotainment, you can watch this video for free.
Hello and welcome everybody to Containers Built for Embedded Systems and Servers. Here you see a little overview of what you're going to hear the next 50 minutes or so. I start with a small introduction of myself and my company. Then we have a look at you might already be familiar with it, but followed by what are containers. As embedded people, you might not know what are containers, and I'm trying to show you here is the idea to build containers with the Okta project, both for your embedded systems and your servers. Then we look at building SDK containers. You might already be familiar with this. I try to show you some use case. There are many more than this. And what I'm really trying to get you to do is to know what's in your containers. So this is now about reproducibility, also size. The bigger the containers are, the more money they cost, both on the server side and on the embedded systems. And the last point here is about open source license compliance. I'm not a lawyer. I want to make you aware of it. And at the very end, it's again, we come back to the Okta project. I show you something called orthogonal concepts with the Okta project. And why would you want to use the Okta project to build your containers? And some last advice here. So let's jump in. My name is Robert Berger. I'm into embedded systems for quite some time. I have my own company based in Austria. I live myself in Greece for, 25 plus years now in the meantime. And here you can see some companies I trained. What I'm trying to show here mainly is, it's not a particular field here. It's very broad. But this is mainly about open source, embedded Linux, Okta project, real time kind of stuff. For many different kinds of companies. To get a little bit more into what I'm doing, what you see here is, I used to do, of course, also in-house trainings before COVID. Now everything moved, of course, online, remote trainings and consulting. So I did my on-site trainings worldwide. I moved back to Europe only. Now it's back worldwide, if you like. Anyhow, it's remote. And of course, you can book additional consulting time if you like. At the moment, not really on-site due to COVID restrictions. My main business is training, lots of stuff involving the Okta project. Also, this is like Okta project plus some embedded Linux refresher. It's introduction to embedded Linux. This as well, introduction to embedded Linux in real time. A shorter course about embedded Linux, kernel, and device drivers. Other embedded Linux debugging course and Priatos, so small real-time operating system. So let's start with what's the Yocto project. Officially, this is what the Yocto community says. It's an open source collaboration project, provides templates, tools, and methods to create your custom Linux-based systems. The idea basically is you build your own embedded Linux distribution from sources. And if you would like to use my framework, which uses, of course, the Yocto project underneath, if you look at this link here, there's a small YouTube video. This one here is a picture you frequently see when people talk about Open Embedded or the Yocto project. Let me very quickly go through this. On the left-hand side, we see various configurations which affect the whole build process. For example, which machine you choose. So whether you build for an ARM or for an x86 or which specific board maybe as well, which compiler is chosen and so on. Then, BB. So these are the BitBake files. These are so-called recipes. They describe how certain things are being built. They describe where to fetch code from. This is what you see up there. Various possibilities, plus mirrors. There's also some caching there to cache the source code. The first step, which is done by BitBake, is just like you would do it yourself, is fetching and download the source code. Afterwards, you might want to apply some changes to it so you can be batched, and then build. In this case, what you see here is AutoTools, but many other build systems are supported by the Yocto project. Then there is some package splitting, output analysis done on your package. You pick one of the three supported package managers. Additional tests are done, and lots of packages end up in the package feed area. And from those packages, basically an image recipe typically decides what should go onto your image, is this path. And from exactly the same metadata, an SDK can be created, which fits exactly the image you were building. An image, you can imagine it as some binary, if you like. There are various output formats which you just flash on your embedded device. So the idea would be just to call up BitBake my image, get the binary. Out of this binary is built from sources, and you flash this binary onto your embedded. All right, so next is containers. Now think about you wanted something like that, some say IoT system, where we have various sensors, and say these sensors output data via MQTT. So we have a MQTT broker, Mosquito. In this case, we have an application called Telegraph. Telegraph understands, so one of the plugins provided by Telegraph supports MQTT. So sensors send the data here. Telegraph can subscribe to this data and feeds them into some database. In this case, I use InfluxDB as a database. And all this could be visualized with another tool called Grafana. What's so special about InfluxDB? It's a time series database. This is exactly what we want. So we kind of want with every end in the database also some kind of timestamp, if you like, and also to be ordered this way. And you can visualize it now in many different ways. They are ready made things. To visualize dashboards, you can create your own dashboard. So this, let's say, is our software stack. And finally, yeah, what you see here is basically an access via some web interface. All this could actually run on an embedded system, or you can split it up whatever you actually like. Now, the classic native approach would be to do something like that here. So say you have your Linux system, and you install now on this Linux system Mosquito, Telegraph, InfluxDB, and Grafana. You configure those components, and that's pretty much it. So we install, in this case, packages onto our classic standard Linux system. This could be a PC, this could be an embedded system. It doesn't really matter too much here. Now, apparently, all these things have their own dependencies, and apparently, we could pick a C library for this in our embedded Linux. So we might use a standard glibc, we might use Mazl because we want it a bit smaller, and so on and so forth. And of course, we have the separation between use and kernel space. This is pretty much a standard Linux system you see here. Now, in the good old days, one would do something like that. So you could have now a server system, let's say, and on your server you install hypervisor, and over this hypervisor you could install now four virtual machines, and each virtual machine now runs one of those software components. You have one VM with Mosquito, one with Telegraph, one with him with Grafana. And note here that they have different dependencies for whatever reason. So here we have like a host Linux Alpine 3.12. And we don't have a standard glibc, we have a Mazl C library. Telegraph, let's say, has a glibc on Debian 9. Same with InfluxDB. Grafana, on the other hand, uses again a different C library, and Alpine. So, well, it's getting tricky now. You cannot install all those on a single machine, on a single system anymore, because it's a different C library. Right. Besides this, okay, we have now a nice clear separation between those components. They can talk to each other via a network interface, typically, so they all communicate via some network. Also note that each of them has their own kernel. So in a virtual machine, we basically simulate the machine, and each VM contains basically what you would normally install on a real machine as well. But there's lots of overhead. So we have kernel, 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 and here another kernel. The more modern approach might be something like that. So we don't use virtual machines, but we use so-called containers. And with these containers, we use a thing called microservices. I'll get to this. Now, this looks pretty much similar to what I just showed you before. But the difference now is that we don't have a hypervisor and a virtual machine. We have a container runtime. And we can still have pretty much the same as we had before. But we can still have different Linux distros and different C libraries and apparently different dependencies in each of those containers. But we don't have, for example, kernel duplicated. So the kernel down here, this one is used also by the containers. And in order to be able to run a container, the underlying operating system needs certain capabilities. We'll get there as well. What I want to show you here is that this is lightweight. So there is potentially some code duplication or some duplication of libraries, because each container contains the application plus its dependencies. So for example, let's say the glibc of Debian 9 between those two would be identical. So there is definitely a duplication. Still in there, it's not a full Debian 9, maybe. It could be something much, much smaller. Apparently, it could be just the application. You could, for example, write the Hello World application in a language of your choice and throw this into a container, and that's fine as well. All right, so if we compare those things again, which we just saw, these three images, then we have the first one, the classic native technology, single device, and this is overall the smallest size. Yeah, there's no duplication here, but it's getting tricky if we need different versions of the same library, and it's getting also tricky, let's say, development-wise, because we have now not so clearly defined borders between various applications. The next is the virtual machine. This is apparently the biggest overall because there's lots of code application. We, of course, can use now different versions. We could even use a different kernel version in different virtual machines and so on. Then we come to the containers. I'm mentioning here Docker. But I try afterwards not to mention Docker too much and just say container, because there are other technologies out there as well. Docker is, of course, very well known, and we will come across it throughout the presentation a couple of times. One container per device, which is rather small. We also need on the host device a container engine. Apparently, for a virtual machine, we also need a hypervisor. And there is some code duplication or binary duplication if we have multiple containers, possibly. This is, in my mind, suitable for a single container on a device. If you want more than one containers on the same device, you could use Docker Compose, for example. There are other technologies also, but we follow the Docker approach. Docker Compose would be the next step. So they can communicate with each other, and Docker Compose can start them up all together or in a certain sequence, or restart things which crash and so on. And the last step here, so there is a technology also by Docker, which is called Docker Swarm, and it's embedded into a recent Docker version. But I prefer to use something more generic here called Kubernetes, which just for the use case, this scales now across the network. So you have additional services somewhere on your network, and they can basically now manage your whole system. So you can update things, you can bring up additional containers if needed, restart, have things redundant, and so on. Yeah, back to the microarchitecture. So this is a quite interesting approach, and our server friends use these for quite some time now. But of course, yeah, as embedded people, we're more conservative. We don't know this kind of stuff. But I'm trying to say we can do this as well. Yeah. So instead of having a huge monolithic application, you can break it down into small, distinct, standalone processes or services. That's one of the ideas of this microarchitecture. And these are so-called microservices, which you can look up here. By the way, you could use this on your embedded system also without containers. Yeah, it's just the idea when you hear microarchitectures and microservices is that you have one service running in one container, provides a certain service, and usually containers communicate with each other via the network. So defined interfaces between those services It's pretty cool. Now on an embedded system, of course, we might want to access devices. We might want to enable and disable so-called capabilities. So this Linux terminology. Certain system calls can be made or not, for example. And with this approach, it's much, much easier to replace services or to integrate services because it's clearly defined interfaces, and one team could work on the one service and the other on the other, and all the dependencies are carried together with one container. This is a pretty cool idea. So this means also teams can work much more independently like this. And we can add more things. We can monitor services, auto-scaling data offloading, so depending on how complex you want it to be. Also, this is possible. So think about some web service that now suddenly many people try to access it. You might spin up automatically more containers. Or you might reroute the data paths differently. So all this is possible. Kubernetes, as I already said, is able to do this. Okay, here I will go through quickly. The slides will be made available to you. You can investigate those keywords on your own. So agile is something which slowly found its way into embedded as well. You might have heard of. Use this. Cloud native is if you produce applications which are scaling in our public or private clouds, or hybrid cloud systems like Kubernetes. DevOps, the idea here is that the development and the IT operations are merging. unfortunately, I don't see this very often in embedded development, so it's more like fighting against each other. So ideally you don't fight, but you work together. And what comes out of this is, of course, continuous integration, testing, and delivery, which is again something practiced many years on the server side of things, but not so much maybe embedded. Here, by the way, this here, the Phoenix Project, is a very interesting book about this subject, which describes a manufacturing plant and how these things can be applied software-wise, or to compare those software and manufacturing plant each other. But GitOps is also something pretty cool and fits the whole scheme of agile microservices and so on. Okay, back to our picture from before. So the classical question people normally ask me now is, well, but what overhead now does the container stuff bring to my system? And well, except for the size, that it might be bigger, not a lot. So what I'm trying to show you here is that even if you don't use a container, and if you use a systemd, for example, which is what's used normally in Linux nowadays, also on embedded systems, it's basically your machine is one container without limits. All the requirements to run a container engine, more or less, are already there if you're able to run systemd. So there's not so much difference there from the kernel, let's say, and from the system configuration. Yeah. So you see here, we need namespaces, which allow us to limit the quality of a service. We have C groups. This allows us to limit and meter the quantity, how much I want this service to run only on a certain CPU. Yeah. Copy on write. So Linux by itself has typically for all the memory subsystem a copy on write strategy, and we need some copy on write storage, which means only things are used, and only if there is a difference, then we need to copy things and to write them somewhere. And we can extend this all with capabilities, SE Linux, up Armor, and so on, to harden the whole system. If we look at Docker, which is something famous, at least on the non-embedded world, but there are also some companies using it for embedded systems. We see this. We have the Docker client. We might also use Docker Compose. We might use a registry, so to pull things from somewhere onto your device, to pull contents onto your device, but this is not necessarily required. So you could load a container onto your system and use this and update it like all the rest of your system, not through a registry. But, you know, it's really up to you. You're really flexible there. And to scale up even more, I would use Kubernetes here. Then we have the Docker engine, of course, used for this. And again, the Docker engine, there are two possibilities, Docker CE and another one. And this relies, at least in my mind, on open source components like Containerd, RunC, container lib network, and so on. And these are standard user space packages for a Linux system. And underneath, it's pretty much what I just showed you before: namespaces, C groups, copy on write storage, and additional features, which most likely you already have on your system, you just don't know and don't know that you use them. Now, when I talk to embedded people, which is what I usually do, and embedded people are usually my customers, then the contact point of them to containers is usually on the host side. So they might use build or SDK containers. Generally speaking, containers provide consistency. A container can be run on many different operating systems. What's inside is kind of defined. So you might not know what's inside, but if you run the same container on different systems, well, it's the same stuff run there. Normally, we have some kind of Linux inside, and they are portable. So as I said, you can run them on various operating systems like Windows, Mac, Linux, and you could even create containers with the Yocto project, for example, for x86-64 and for ARM32 and ARM64 and many other systems. Yeah, there are so-called multi-arc containers. I can do this with the Yocto project and Flix. So as I said, most likely, you might already be using containers as SDK containers, maybe. So it's x86-64 executables, And the reason would be that all your developers have a defined identical build environment. And also if you use a continuous integration system to build your code, you might want to use the same container there, just to unify the build environment. Yeah. I see the use case here, developer workflow. So clearly, yeah, your daily work, compilation, building things, testing things, checking things into some version control, all this could be done from some a container. You might also use so-called build containers. What's this? For me, this is, again, the reason is to have an identical build environment for everybody who uses Bitbake. So Bitbake is used by Open Embedded in the Octo project. You build packages with it, you build images with it, and so on. And of course, for the DevOps workflow, so for continuous integration, testing, delivery, which is basically triggered by some kind of check-in, for example, when the developer says, okay, this looks good now, I want my stuff to be automatically tested. So, yeah. Either build things manually with Bitbake, or in the DevOps workflow, it's triggered a build, nightly build, or however you want to do it. If you don't use SDK or build containers now, start using them. I highly recommend this. Now, let me show you another embedded use case. So say we have a system like this. We have here sensors. Those sensors might be, you know, really small things running something like the Sapphire operating system or FreeRTOS or something like that. Then we have Edge systems, which are Linux, Fog, again, Linux, and Cloud, again, Linux, but of course, smaller, bigger, big, and the Cloud could be at some customer's premises, or the Cloud could be somewhere in the internet. Now, for such a system, if you think about it, I will not get into the details down here, then for those three systems, I suggest a microservice architecture. So use containers, use Kubernetes even, if you can. And this will allow you to completely scale things. So what I mean by that is that no matter if it's for an x86-64, which might be the hosted cloud, or if it's for an x86-64, which is the on-premises cloud, or the Fog, which is maybe a 64-bit ARM, or the Edge, which is a 32 or 64-bit ARM. Yeah? No matter where those things are, by using microservice architectures and containers, you could quite easily move things around between those different things. Of course, it will require rebuilding those kind of things, so recompiling the kind of things. But this is possible in the Octo project. So if you do what I suggest, you use the Octo project to build your containers, this can be done. Now, people usually don't know what's inside the containers. So I highly recommend that you try to find it out, or to build it in such a way so you know from the beginning what's inside by building things from sources. Why would you want to know? Well, one thing is, as I say here, a software upgrade. If you don't know what's inside, how do you do a software upgrade? Or bug fixes, or new features, or, well, if we get now into attack surfaces and those kind of things, of course you need to know pretty well what's inside. Security, safety, and so on. Yeah, here I have also a link with CVEs. which you can have a look at. Do you build everything from sources? Well, if not, how do you know what's inside? Yeah. In theory, with a binary distro and reproducible builds, you might have a chance to find out, but try. I don't say anything else. If you build from sources, and also if you don't build from sources, how can you do offline builds? Yeah, offline meaning no connection to the internet. So some projects require this. You need to have somewhere the ideally sources, but maybe also the recompiled packages, so you can build the stuff if you're offline. And this is, well, because repositories might just go away on the internet. This is one reason. The other reason is some projects require this. You're not allowed to bring things from outside. I think about military or medical projects. They might procedure-wise require something like that. And why else would you care? Legal issues, we get there. I'm not a lawyer, but I talk a little bit about open source license compliance. And yeah, there are also different kinds of legal claims. So the Yocto project in the meantime has thousands of packages which are bit exact reproducible. Yeah, we're not there yet that everything is 100% bit exact reproducible, but that's the plan basically. So this is how a Docker container might look like, or better to say, Docker file for a Docker container might look like. Yeah, and then my question is, do you know what's inside? Yeah, so from Ubuntu 20.04 pulls in packages. You don't know how many, you don't know which. And with the get, update, upgrade, and so on, you pull in random versions, which are currently today the latest and greatest. What I'm doing in line 5 is another funny thing. So I work around the package management. I just copy here some Git repo on my root file system, and so on. So what I'm trying to say is, with open source license compliance, for some licenses, you need to be able to provide so-called corresponding sources. You can't with this. It's not corresponding source. Each line in the Docker file, roughly speaking, creates a so-called Docker layer also. And multiple layers can contain unused but shipped software. Since you ship it, since you put the stuff into distribution, you also need to take care, even if it's not used, about the license compliance. I already said this, a Docker file is not the corresponding source, so we get there with licenses. And you should definitely back your own code also with a package manager. Otherwise, even if you try to, how can you collect licenses and so on in somehow defined way? Now, if we use OpenEmbed or the Yocto project, we could use this one. We could use a class which comes with a standard reference implementation called Poki. And if you build a root file system with the image container bbglass, you can add this to a Docker file. Or containers also provide standardization. There is an Open Container Initiative, OCI. And if you pull in a meta layer called meta virtualization, and you use this class here, then you can directly create so-called OCI images, and you can either bundle this into your image or upload it to some registry or do whatever you do with your container images. Now, the next thing here is size. So what I did here is I tried to do something like you see here. I just tried to add, to take some small base image and add to this a small web server light DPD. I did this with Ubuntu, and Ubuntu pulls in 177 packages, which end up in 9 layers, 258 meg size. A tool called Dive tells me 46 megs wasted space. Well, I believe it's more than this. So if you look at the money you pay on your cloud provider, you see that it's a matter of size, of CPU used, of RAM used, of storage used, and so on. So if you have many instances on the cloud, or if you have an embedded system, so these are parallel issues. I saw them many times between huge systems and small embedded systems. It's exactly the same story. So you want this thing to be as small as possible. So what people do normally is they don't use Ubuntu, but they use Alpine. Alpine is pretty popular for containers. And here we have only 28 packages, and we shrink from 258 megs to 14 megs, yeah, which is like a decrease of 94%, or an increase of 1,700, depending on which side you want to see this from. The next approach, yeah, so less resources means less costs. And of course, as I said, yeah, it's interesting for those for the real big cloud systems or the not so powerful embedded system. There you really see the issue more clearly. Now, what I did here was I built the same thing with the Octo project for some x86 in this case, but I can do the same thing for an ARM 3264. So suddenly I only had 14 megs. And I had 8.7 megs size without doing any kind of optimization. So I should mention what I wrote here with Alpine. They don't use, like I write down here, they don't use a full glibc.
Wir sind da in einem kleineren Grossraumbüro.
Bei den Leuten habe ich die Freiheit, dass ich, wenn ich anfange und wenn ich höre mit dem Arbeiten, eigentlich kann selber einteilen kann.
Overall, how I will do it, it's just up to me and they give me a lot of freedom.
Für mich ist die Faszination, mit anderen Leuten einen kreativen Moment zu generieren.
Great colleagues, great environment basically.
It's really nice here and I don't have any issues living here.
Meistens schätze ich in den Leica G-Systems, dass wir ein sehr junges Team sind, sowie dass ich auch meine Arbeitszeit in einem gewissen Umkreis selber bestimmen
kann. And I could merge in my life hobby with my office job.
Das Besondere an den Leica G-Systems ist sicher die Kultur und die Dynamik, die es gibt in dem Team. Es ist jeden Tag ein bisschen anders.
We have good organization, which will help you to get used to the company in the first couple of months especially.
Das ist sehr interessant und ja, macht mir Spaß.
They use a thing called Mazel, which is a small C library. I don't do this. So although I don't do this and although I added to my image license text and other license related information, which I would recommend, the size went from 14 to 8.7 megabytes. And then I started to play around. So the next step was I removed the licensing text and I went from 8.7 to 8.5. And the last one, I replaced the glibc with the Mazel library. I went to 5.2 megs. Yeah. So really without lots of effort, I went from 258 megs to 5.2 megs. Okay, that's the same thing. And I could make it even smaller if I really wanted to. Like, for example, you remember the thing we saw before with Telegraph and so on. So I played around with Telegraph. And if you build yourself Telegraph, you could, for example, say, okay, I need only those input plugins for Telegraph. Telegraph is, by the way, written in Go. And it ends up in one single binary. And you can tell it, okay, I only need those input plugins in some custom configuration. And yeah, it's going to be even smaller. So what I'm trying to say is, if you build things from source, ideally with the Octo project, you could even optimize things further and make it smaller and reduce the runtime costs of the system. Here, by the way, from the 14 packages, remember 7, 8 are related to the web server. So if I know exactly what you need, I could even just install those which are needed. Yeah, open source license compliance. I am not a lawyer, so I can get you in touch with lawyers if you want to know about this stuff. This applies to the distribution of binaries. So it's containers, but not only, in general, if you distribute binaries which are licensed with certain open source licenses. So what you need to do is, and this is really small, I have a whole day about only the subject, and here it's just one slide. Organizational. So if you use copyleft license, which means GPL, I think 2.3, then a derivative work also becomes same license. So what's a derivative work? Well, linking statically against GPL makes a derivative work. If it's GPL version 2, modified files must carry prominent notices stating that you changed the files and the date of any change. So in addition to this, who changed what when needs also to be provided. And with GPL version 3, user must be able to install modified versions of the OSS components on a device. So GPL 2, it's just necessary for the user to build it. GPL 3, build and install. Which might be a bit of a challenge if you have DRM or secure boot or those kind of things on your system. Then we have information documentation. Yeah, you must ship the license text somehow, and there are also copyright notices, who are the copyright holders, which need to be provided, and depending on the license, for example, the original BSD4 license, there are special notices, meaning if you use something like this, you have to mention this in your ads and brochures. Interesting. I just found it out, I don't know, 2-3 months ago when I looked into this. I looked into open source compliance and the Octo project. Closer for some customer. And for certain licenses, you also need to provide the corresponding sources, meaning to produce exactly what is on your device, plus the build instructions, as I said, with GPL3, also installation instructions. By the way, here's a tool you could use. This is also pretty new to me, at least, which could be used to investigate your existing source code and to add, for example, SPDX records to it. The next here is, if we look now on our three containers and license compliance, then things get a bit spooky. On the Ubuntu image, there are 163 licenses, also none and unknown, which I found. So I would say it's nicely said, hard and difficult to get the open source compliance out of this stuff. Same with Alpine. On Ubuntu, Ubuntu uses packages from Debian, and Debian did quite some work on reproducible builds. And the whole idea is that if you have reproducible builds, you could also find out the source code and rebuild exactly from the source code. But yeah, well, I didn't succeed there so far. Alpine does not have reproducible builds, so things get much more difficult. So I just can't, what I'm trying to say to you, did you ever try to rebuild from sources? Those kind of things. Now here, which is basically built with the Octo project, of course, this is much easier. So if you don't use a binary distro, if you use a distro which builds from sources, you have the sources to build stuff. And you know exactly where you don't have the sources from, because you have to include the binaries. Then the party starts anyways. So yeah, I can provide license text. There is a special class which can provide the corresponding source. There's even a feature with another layer where I can upload whatever was built to a thing called Fossology, and then you can analyze things. That's a laborious work, but yeah, it's possible. And if you create your Yocto layers accordingly, you could even dish out your meta layer or your meta layers, which don't contain your proprietary code, and people can then rebuild. Everything is good. So this is basically what I suggest. What's important is not only for containers, but also for the native system. But in containers, yeah, I see a huge issue nowadays. All right, at the end here, it's something which is built into the Yocto project. We have these so-called orthogonal concepts of machine, distribution, and image. What I'm trying to show you here is various combinations. So the idea is that you change one and you do not influence the others. That's the idea here. So what I'm trying to say here is I'm showing here three machines. I'm showing a container x86-64, a container ARM V7, which is a 32-bit ARM, and a Multi V7ML, which is not the container. This is a system. An image comes out of this, which runs directly on various embedded ARM boards. By the way, these are mine. It comes out of my my layers, these names and the functionality. So you won't find this upstream like it is here. Now the distro, again, it's my naming, and also the image is my naming here. The distro, I have a container distro. This is a global embedded systems. There is it. This is with a glibc. This here is with Mazel. So as you see, the first two things basically build the same container image. It's an image which would run on your PC in an x86 64 Docker container, for example, and contains this web server. In this case with a glibc, in this case with Mazel, meaning smaller size. Here I do exactly the same thing. So I kept those identical, but I change now from x86 64 to ARM 32. By just changing the machine here to another machine, I can build exactly the same thing, but it is of course to be cross-compiled now for ARM 32 with a glibc or with a Mazel library. Yeah, Or the third thing which I show here, I could also, so these things here, as I mentioned before, they would involve an extra step. So Yocto would just build for me a root file system, and then I have to add this root file system into a Docker file, and then to either embed the and then use Docker to build a Docker image and embed this into my image, or upload it to some registry and pull it on my device. Here you see I built now another image, and this image is now an OCI image, so there is no more Docker or whatever other stuff involved in the build process. And I can take this and again embed it into my image or upload it to some registry. I'm using a tool called Scopio to upload it to some registry. All right, the last five things are standard Linux images. So this is, if you like, this is a Linux distribution. And you see here, it's the same machine and the same distro, but I built here another image. So in the one, in this one, I support Docker and Docker Compose. And here I support Portman and Portman Compose. Yeah. So you can now quite easily also play with those kind of things. And the last three here, it's very easy now. What we had in our container, imagine the developer develops stuff on the x86 in a container. This is cross-compiled in a container for ARM and run on your embedded system. But let's say for whatever reason, resources, boot time, I don't know, something, you say, okay, no, I don't want it in a container. I want it to run natively on my embedded system. Then you do what I show here at the very end. I have now another image, and this is now not the container, but it just embeds another package, the LightDPD package, into my root file system. And I can build it with a glibc or Mazel. And by the way, by default, I'm using system 5, not system D, but I also made a Razer system D distro. Now system D is enabled and all this runs with system D. Just saying, if you use Yocto project, you can do this. You can move things around, different architect, different machines, and different distros, native or in the container. All right, so yeah, we have an archive of BBcas where we can archive source code for offline builds. We can archive source code filters for license compliance. So this is to give out to your customers. We have a build history class so we understand what changed in the image, and this can also help us with hardening the image. We have a CV check BBcas which checks against a common vulnerability and exposure database, CCV database, and it will tell you, take care, this specific package which you use here, this version has these and these known issues. And there are various soft upgrade layers and servers and stuff available as well, and much more. Anyways, we're getting now to the end. As I said, the image could be a container, or it could be native. Know what's in your containers. I highly recommend this. Also, what's out of your containers, by the way. Yeah, of course. Base system should be known as well if you ship this, and this is what you do on your embedded system, likely. Ideally, everything is built from sources. Yeah, I'm saying ideally because some things might be really hard to build. Some things, you get them only as binaries. You should, yeah, by now, know my opinion why you should build from sources. Technically speaking, you need to maintain, support, optimize your system, no matter if it's native or containers or native and containers. for some time, 10 years. There's a new law now, by the way, in the EU, which says, which talks about 10 years or so. must be able to be repaired for 10 years. Let's see how well this goes. But yeah, with many of my customers who are anyways in not only in consumer, but in industrial control and other systems, they have to support their systems at least 10 years. Legally, yeah, mitigate the risk of being sued. So some people might be just after your money, or communities might be after really after open source compliance, or software developers who wrote some code and you modified and they don't dish out your modifications, or trolls. They all might be wanting to you. You might also want to harden your system by additional static dynamic code checks and other means. And yeah, stay tuned for what you're going to hear from me next once I find the time and once these things settle a bit. I'm going to do the next step and try to integrate Kubernetes on embedded systems as well. Of course, by using Meta Virtualization and the Octo project. So thank you very much. My name is Robert Berger. Here you see my company. Thanks for watching, and feel free to get in touch with me for this and related questions. Thank you.
If you found this video informative, make sure to subscribe our channel. Click the thumbs up if you liked it, or leave us a comment on what we could improve. If you are looking for a job in the embedded industry, or you've got one to offer, drop us a mail to jobs@embo.io. That's jobs@embo.io. And we'll make sure that you match up. My name is Stefan Bückelmann, and as long as you keep watching, we'll keep covering the internals of the embedded industry. If you found this video informative, make sure to subscribe our channel. Click the thumbs up if you liked it, or leave us a comment on what we could improve. If you are looking for a job in the embedded industry, or you've got one to offer, drop us a mail to jobs@embo.io. That's jobs@embo.io. And we'll make sure that you match up. My name is Stefan Bückelmann, and as long as you keep watching, we'll keep covering the internals of the embedded industry.